各位觀眾，歡迎來到我們農場頻道的周一長談。我們最近這一段時間都很多時候講到中加之間的關係，加拿大和中國在12月開始突然之間爆發了一個非常大的事件，就是在美國的要求底下，就我們加拿大就拘捕了華為的副董事長，也是華為創辦人的女兒孟晚舟小姐的。因為他在加拿大被拘捕的緣故，就引發了加中之間兩國一個非常大的外交風波，以至到影響到不單止是外交的層面，也都是對我們國民之間的一個溝通，人與人之間的交流，甚至是講到中加的貿易關係的。所以我們今天的周一長談，就希望能夠就著中加的關係，就著孟晚舟事件所帶來的影響，來作出一個大家都可以有一個討論的。今天我們很高興在我們當中有戴國偉先生 Mr. Stockwell Day 在我們當中。戴國偉先生也不需要我們太多的介紹了，他在前朝的保守黨哈柏政府底下擔任過很多重要的職位，包括了國際貿易，包括了加拿大的國庫部的局長等等這些重要職位。他在離開2011年退位，不再在聯邦的政壇上面參與的時候，他也在很多的層面上面，譬如說這個中加的貿易的關係局等等，來作一個很大的貢獻的。所以我們今天希望能夠透過和戴國偉先生的一個討論，我們能夠看到中加之間有什麼的危機，我們的關係裡面有什麼突破的機會，以及在現在的情況裡面我們有什麼的他可以給到我們的一些提示。 We welcome you Mr. Stockwell Day. Welcome to the MF Forum.
Great to be with you, thanks.
So as I was saying in the introduction,China and Canada has a long relationship ever since the establishment of the Chinese national in the 40s, in the 1940s in last century. Canada has already established diplomatic relationship. Since the communists took power in China in the 1970s, Canada was also one of the earliest Western countries to establish diplomatic relationship with it. Now, given you would think,that given this long-lasting relationship, very deeply rooted relationship, we wouldn't be seeing a situation that we are seeing today. Do you know, can you provide us some highlight and hindsight into what is going on?
Well, I can certainly try. I mean, first, you're right to talk about the long-standing relationship. It goes back generations, it goes back many decades. Still, they talk in schools in China about Dr. Norman Bethune. He's still almost like a national hero in terms of all the work he did there in the early, very early days. And you're right in terms of diplomatic relations. As a matter of fact, Canada led the world in wheat sales to China way back as far as Prime Minister, Conservative Prime Minister Diefenbaker,
right,
back in the late 50s. And even my own family, on a personal side, my grandfather was among the Canadian soldiers who, in 1941, defended Hong Kong in the Battle of Hong Kong.
Right.
And he was, along with many Canadian soldiers, he was captured, was a prisoner of war for 4 years. So there's a lot of diplomatic, business, and in fact, family ties between Canada and China that continues. But you know, relationships between countries, in a way, they're like relationships between people. So you can have a friendship with somebody, or you can compare it to a marriage. We're not married to China. But in any relationship, no matter how strong the foundations of that relationship, there's always going to be challenges. There's going to be disagreements. And how you handle those disagreements, that will have great bearing on how the relationship continues.
Well, some actually said that the Meng Wanzhou's case is just a matter of time. With China become more assertive in the international stage, Canada, it's just a matter of time before Canada will have to face an expanding China that is trying to assert its influence around the world. Do you agree this is just a last straw on the camel's back?
No, it's one of many straws, and there's going to be many more, you know, right, in the relationship. So we have to, one of the things I think nations like Canada can learn from a nation like China is how to take the longer view. First of all, an incident or a case in and of itself is important. This particular case is very important. But we also have to keep in mind the longer view. Relations with China will continue. When, you know, you're probably familiar with the famous story when Henry Kissinger was first opening up diplomatic relationships, the relationship with China, and in an after-dinner conversation with the then premier of China, he asked, they were just having an intellectual discussion on history. And he said, what do you think about the French Revolution? Was it a success? And the premier of China paused for a minute and he said, it's too early to tell. You know, so that was a revolution that took place, you know, now close to 300 years ago. And one thing that I think we can learn from China is they take the long view. So this is one of a number of incidents, but it has to be handled carefully because there can be some immediate circumstances that are negative to both countries if this situation isn't handled correctly.
Well, speaking of long view in terms of timeline, the Meng Wanzhou situation here, I wonder, as in many of the pundit state, people wonder whether it's avoidable. If we have a time machine that allows you to travel back in time, what would you have advised the government to have done differently?
Well, first, I'm not going to assume they could have done it better, but I would want to be sure that when the first request came in to detain, whenever we get a request to detain somebody, and we get a request that's come from a country that with whom we have a treaty, an extradition treaty, you've got to look at it very carefully. And you really have to, as far as you can determine, because remember, this is a case that has not actually come to a court anywhere yet.
No.
So you have to determine the possibilities that a significant legal infraction has taken place. You'll remember the case with a certain Mr. Lai.
Right.
A number of
Lai
years
Chung
ago.
Sing.
That's
yes.
right. And he was here in Canada. China wanted him back.
Right.
And we looked at the case. We looked at what he was charged with in China, defrauding, you know, many, many people. And we made a determination that there was likelihood that there was merit to the charges. And so we said to China, yes, we will move to get him back to you. Now, at that particular point, he then claimed certain refugee asylum status, and then a whole other process in Canada kicks into place where he is allowed, any person is allowed to appeal for some asylum. And then you have to let the courts deal with that. This is where we're different than China. Mm-hmm. Politicians and many people, Chinese leadership, don't understand this. That our political system is deliberately set up so that it's separate from the court system. In Canada, a politician, even a prime minister, cannot tell the courts what to do. It's specifically, deliberately set up that way. And but what we did do was we made a determination. We looked at all the evidence and we said, there's a strong chance this is not just political, that this man may indeed, there's likelihood he committed these crimes of fraud, and we want to get him back to China. So I'm hoping in this case that evaluation was made by the federal liberals. They looked at everything and said, this isn't political, this is in fact legal or criminal, and that was the basis on what, on the detention. I hope that's what they did.
Right. So that didn't actually pan out, I think, right now, because Meng Wanzhou, it's now being retained or detained in Canada. She is actually serving, staying in under many conditions, staying at home with a monitoring system and so on and so forth, subject to the U.S. in filing an extradition case. Now, if that didn't happen, Then I guess Canada, it's free to go. But what happened in the meanwhile with the latest incarceration of several Canadians, two of which were known as former diplomat, and the other one is a businessman working with North Korea, and also Robert Lloyd Schellenberg's situation. Many in the media started to refer China as being bullish. Canada may well be incompetent in dealing with China, not able to respond soon enough. But given this situation and with the ambassador in China writing a scolding editorial in Hill Times recently, it seems like our relationship is on a cliff. Pretty much downhill cliff. What could be the worst case scenario from your point of view?
Well, the relationship is strained for sure over this. And just to back it up one step, Canada so far has been maintaining that this case related to the detention here in Canada is a legal matter.
Right.
However, since making the detention and since detaining this woman, President Trump has come out with a number of statements saying, you know, now that the Canadians have agreed and have detained her, now maybe we can use this as some pressure for our trade talks. And at that point, I said, whoa, wait a minute now. Now we have the President of the United States, the president of the country who said that this is a legal matter, suggesting that it's probably or could be also political. So my suggestion to our government at this point is, if they so choose, they could make a determination that this is actually a political case, this is a political dispute between the US and China, and we aren't going to detain this woman any longer. So President Trump has opened the door for them to make that ruling. Now, whether our government will take that or not, I don't know. Keep in mind also that the company itself, Huawei, of which the woman is obviously a significant leader in that company, it is said that they have done some business with Iran under the name of a subsidiary company called Skycom. And that's violating some treaties. Canada should also keep in mind that Germany, for instance, does a lot of business with Iran. Great Britain does a lot of business with Iran. Many European countries do. As a matter of fact, the United States itself was just involved in an approval of a port project related to Iran. They gave approval for it. So I'm just bringing that up to say there are opportunities, I believe, if the federal Liberal government want to pursue them, to say this thing is political. We hope the US and China get it settled, but we don't believe there are sufficient legal grounds for us to detain this. So that opportunity is there. And then the second part of your question, you know, how bad can things get? Things can get bad.
All right.
China could make some significant decisions that could affect investment in Canada, could affect people traveling. Certainly Canadians are worried right now about travel to China. Maybe the worry is over-exaggerated, but it's there. It could also, I mean, I wouldn't like to see it get to this, but there are products, many products that Canada has that China is very interested in. Anything from grain sales to pharmaceuticals to health products,
energies,
on and on it goes, you know. So anytime there's a strain like this, it's not good for both countries. I do think whether China agrees with this or not, their image right now is being somewhat tarnished, not just in Canada, but with other countries. You use the word bullying in terms of I don't know the details on these two people that were arrested, the two Canadians. And Mr. Schellenberg, you know, they appealed his 15-year sentence for the drug crime, and the appeal has resulted now in the death sentence.
Yep.
China can say it's not related, but the timing of all these things does not help China's international image. So Canada has something to lose on a trade side, and I believe China may have something to lose on the diplomatic side.
在中國和加拿大之間的關係呢，有很多地方都是對我們個人，我們對普通的加拿大人都有關係的，不論是人員之間的交流啦，或者是一些貿易上面的往來啦。那我們看看一陣在下一節裡面呢，繼續會跟戴國偉先生來講講究竟中加關係呢，我們在未來的發展裡面有些什麼可以突破的地方，有些什麼危機，也有什麼的機會呢，讓我們可以改進的。那我下一節回來的時候再跟大家聊。